ICT Qatar had this interview with Mr. Gwalem Lewis. Mr. Gwalem, can you tell us first about web accessibility and how the idea all started?
Web accessibility is something that has been developed over time by predominantly or primarily the World Wide Web Consortium, mm-hmm. which is also known as W3C.
Okay.
W3C are an organization that was set up in 1994 by the people effectively that created the internet to come up with a set of standards for web interoperability, okay. making sure that the web had universal access for all and worked across all devices.
Okay.
And one of the prime directives of W3C, after making sure that the web works for all devices and all machines, was also to make sure that it's available for everyone that actually uses the web, and this includes obviously people that have some kind of impairment, disability that doesn't allow them to actually access web pages.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me.
Okay.
Their first guidelines were created in 1999. And are referred to as the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines version 1.
Mm-hmm.
And what they set out are a number of goals and issues that people need to address when they're building websites to make sure that websites are properly accessible.
Uh-huh.
They set kind of three levels of website accessibility, which commonly are known as Conformance Level A,
okay.
Which is a basic standard of website accessibility. AA, which is a much greater level of accessibility, and then AAA, which is where a website is perfectly accessible.
Mm-hmm.
And these standards actually refer to a document that the W3C consortium came up with, which can be found at www.w3.org,
mm-hmm.
and then if you look for accessibility on that website, I think that's about it.
Okay. Which countries are currently applying the Web Accessibility Initiative or the tips of Web Accessibility?
Some of the key countries that are applying the web accessibility guidelines are the most European countries under a human rights code of practice.
Mm-hmm.
So that would include obviously the UK, France, Germany, etc. The USA under the Americans with Disabilities Access Act. And interestingly, there's been some case law in Australia back from 2000.
Mm-hmm.
What's difficult at the moment is whilst website accessibility is referred to in legal documents, there's been very, very little case law to actually prove who is liable if a site isn't accessible, and even if they should be liable.
Mm-hmm.
Two very clear cases that have been settled in the last few years, and they're actually quite old, mm-hmm. was one in 2000, where an Australian gentleman sued the Sydney Olympics Games Organising Committee for the website not being accessible.
Mm-hmm.
And this was actually on the point that they hadn't added alternative text for any images that were supplied, and the judgment went in his favour, and the Sydney Organising Committee were fined to $20,000,
mm-hmm.
and this has been used as case law for a lot of other cases. At around the same time, Priceline.com, who are a flight booking and hotel booking service,
mm-hmm.
and Ramada Hotels were taken to court in the US on the grounds that their websites weren't accessible.
Uh-huh.
These cases were originally dismissed by the American courts on the basis that a website was not a public place, and therefore the Americans with Disabilities Act didn't apply.
Mm-hmm.
But they were then later taken to court by the state of New York, and mm-hmm. were both required to pay for the cost of the investigation that happened with the state of New York, and also to set their websites in order and make them accessible. So whilst they weren't actually found guilty,
mm-hmm.
They still were financially penalised for their websites not being accessible.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there hasn't a lot that's happened since, but it's very safe to assume that these bits of case law will be used as precedents in other actions going forward. Mm. And therefore, in Europe, in the US, and in Australia at least, and there is some other legislation similar to this in Japan, then people will potentially be liable for not having accessible websites.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, what equipment or browsers or software that can the persons with disabilities have to possess in order to be able to access a website that has been developed specifically for them, or an accessible website? So, what equipment should they be having?
There's actually, at a most basic level, no need for any additional equipment for a person having impairments being able to access a website.
Mm-hmm.
Modern browsers allow for websites to increase the size of the text that are displayed to show a version of the website that possibly, you know, doesn't show images, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so for most people, a normal browser is absolutely fine. Now, generally for people that are visually impaired, and I guess this is, you know, the biggest area where people have issues accessing the web,
yeah.
Then there are two very specific technologies that people can use that are added on to their browsers.
Yeah.
One is a technology known as a screen reader, and it literally reads aloud the words that are printed on the website. And so the website needs to be structured to make sure that for a computer reading through the website, it makes sense. And this is important for things such as how the navigation elements work, how images are described, and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
The other technology that is available, and is less well used, but is still used to a considerable extent, is a Braille reader. And this works in exactly the same way as a screen reader, except that rather than reading the website aloud, it turns the text into Braille. So the user will have a Braille pad, and they'll be able to actually read the website off of the Braille machine. For both of these technologies to work, if the website isn't created properly, i.e. it's not accessible, they'll both fail, and therefore the user won't be able to access the website properly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So for an institution who would like to make its website accessible to visually impaired people or persons with disabilities generally, is this step an expensive way to, I mean, is upgrading the website to be accessible for all, is it an expensive step for a company to take, for any institution?
That's a very interesting question and a very difficult question to answer. To upgrade a website, it very much depends on when the site was built and how the site was built. For some people's sites, it could be simply a matter of adding some extra information about, say, image names, and that will be enough to take the website to a AA accessible standard, which is the one that most the European Union, say, and the Americans consider to be an acceptable level of accessibility.
Mm-hmm.
For other sites, unfortunately, making a site accessible may actually mean rebuilding the entire site from scratch. For instance, if a site was built some time ago using a Flash Technologies interactive rich media, it may be that considerable work is required.
Mm-hmm.
But one has to understand that this is a necessary step, and this is something that companies and organizations need to be doing, not only to comply with legislation in different countries around the world, but also to provide the same level of experience to anyone that accesses the internet.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so do you think that governmental and commercial entities will be equally interested to take such a step and upgrade their websites?
In general terms, government entities tend to be the first adopters, or the people that are most concerned about this, because for most government entities, they have a mandate to provide equal service for everybody. And by having a website that doesn't allow people that are visually impaired or physically impaired to access their website, means that they're
Okay, so in your opinion, what further web developments need to be done in the future to support what the Web Accessibility Initiative calls for? So what additional developments should be or are required in the future?
I think that the main thing for the future is actually for web developers and for people that are having websites built, because it really needs to be led by the person whose website it is, or the entity whose website it is, to understand that websites need to be developed in order to support accessibility. And so this is not necessarily a technology development. Mm. It's actually more a mindset shift, that people understand that there is a broad audience and the web should be accessible for everyone. And once that's in place, and once people understand this, then actually websites become a lot more accessible generally. From a technology point of view, the world is changing and browser technology is improving all the time. So, for instance, some of the latest versions of browsers allow, for instance, the entire screen to be enlarged, whether the website has been built to be accessible or not. Mm-hmm. Now, this is great for people that have a degree of visual impairment, because they can actually, you know, make the screen size larger and see what's happening. But of course, it doesn't work for people that are using assistive technologies such as screen readers. So, yeah, whilst technology will continue to help people use the web, there isn't a substitute for actually building websites properly and making sure they're accessible at a fundamental level. And then any advances in technology just add to this, rather than allowing technology to compensate for not building a site properly in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so finally, our last question would be that every company or any organization in general would always like to measure the results of its efforts. So when a company or any institution takes the step of upgrading the website for and making it more accessible, how can it actually measure the outcome or the results of its step? How can it make sure that the web is really accessible and it's it has succeeded in its purpose?
In confirming whether a website is accessible and thus the organisation has met its goals. At a very technical level, then there are a number of tools that exist on the web. And again, yeah, the place to find these is at the World Wide Web Consortium, W3C, which allow web developers to submit pages that have been developed to a testing tool, and it will then report which level of compliance that the website meets, and therefore whether it is accessible or not. More interestingly, personally, I think, you know, the best way to find out if a website works and is accessible is actually to do what ICT and CASA have done recently, which is then take their accessible websites into the real world. And in ICT and CASA's example, they went to the NOR Institute, which uses assistive technologies for people that are visually impaired, so braille readers and screen readers, and actually physically get people that are visually impaired to use the website. Yeah, and this is a very easy way to check, and also a very good way to actually satisfy oneself that everything works properly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We'd like to thank you, Mr. Guillaume Lewis, for your time and valuable insights. Thank you very much.